information that's on your side. This is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
Reports of an active shooter turn out to be a hoax, but the feeling of not knowing can still be traumatic. We're talking with mental health experts about how to move forward after something like this happens. First up, we're learning more about those five people arrested after a woman was found locked inside a dog cage last night. Deputies with the Richmond County Sheriff's Office say she was found inside a mobile home on Nellie Drive. That's near Peach Orchard Road. Authorities have now identified the suspects as Angelica Figueroa, Dawson Weston, DeMichael Dawson, Savannah Piazzi, and Shauna Powell. Their ages ranging from 18 to 29 years old. Will Rio here in the studio now with a deeper look at what they're charged with in this case and their previous run-ins with the law.
Well, I've been digging into this case all day, including talking with neighbors and people who knew the suspects. We found that three of the suspects had previous cases in Richmond County. Neighbors say that this isn't the first time cops have been called to that house, and they say that they're relieved these suspects are behind bars.
On the 2200 block of Nellie Drive in Augusta, neighbors were able to confirm that this was the home these five suspects were arrested on November 29th. Shauna Powell, Angelica Figueroa, DeMichael Dawson, Savannah Piazzi, and Dawson Weston are charged with kidnapping, false imprisonment, aggravated assault, and a weapons charge.
I'm glad that I can bring my daughter outside and I have to worry about gunshots going off or anything like that.
Neighbors say this isn't the first time deputies have been called to the home. It's also not the first time we've heard the last name of one of the suspects arrested. Court documents confirm Angelica Figueroa is married to Carlos Figueroa. Carlos is currently awaiting trial in Richmond County after being charged with the murder of Alan Newsom back in March on Olm Road. We looked into previous cases for every suspect involved and found charges against more than half of them. Shauna Powell has two simple battery family violence charges from 2018 and 2019, a terroristic threats charge from 2021, and operating an unauthorized vehicle with blue lights from 2022. Angelica Figueroa has a simple battery family violence charge from 2019. DeMichael Dawson has arson, burglary, and giving false statements to law enforcement from 2017, and theft by receiving stolen property in 2021. As for Savannah Piazzi and Dawson Weston, neither of them have previous cases against them.
We've been dealing with this for like months now. I'm glad they're in jail, because we don't have to deal with it anymore.
We have reached out to the Richmond County Sheriff's Office and the Augusta 911 Dispatch Center to see just how many times deputies have been called to this address. We'll keep you updated as we learn more with this case.
Certainly a shocking case, Will. Thanks for the update on it. To weather now as we give you a live lookout. Thanks, Riley. See you then. We do have some new video to show you out of South Florida where police are looking for a North Augusta woman in connection to this fatal hit and run. This video shows the moment the victim is hit Sunday night. The impact actually happens off screen to the left and then the car involved, which we froze there in the middle of the screen. But investigators in Miramar, Florida say 28-year-old Johnny Lewis is wanted for as a person of interest in what turned out to be a deadly hit and run. Police in Miramar, near Miami, also releasing new video and images of Miss Lewis. They say she was last seen here in the Augusta area driving a silver Chevy Malibu that was not the one involved in the crash. But if you have any information on where Janae Lewis might be, you're urged to call police, and we listed that number here on your screen as well as attached to this story online. Fallout continues after yesterday's school shooting hoax, both at Westside High School here in Augusta and all around Georgia. School leaders planning to meet with law enforcement to talk about the next steps. And the FBI is investigating the source of the hoax. We're on your side tonight with how parents and students can learn to cope with a traumatic experience. Nick Veland live in our newsroom. Nick, what are you hearing from the mental health experts this evening?
Yeah, well, it's all about talking today about the experiences of yesterday. The initial fear of getting the notification of your child's school being in a lockdown. Finding out it was a hoax is a relief, but the moments before can cause a traumatic experience.
You get a message that there's a potential shooter in a school where your child is, and it's a moment of just shock and terror.
A moment many parents found out about on social media. Now, moving forward, Dr. Candace Best from AU says it's okay for the parents to open up to their child.
I was scared. I was terrified. I thought something might have happened to you. I thought maybe I could lose you. That is one of the most understated places that we can begin to impact on our children. Because for them to know that it's okay to be scared, it's okay, you know, our parents have the same emotion.
The executive director of the American School Counselor Association says children will know if parents are impacted.
They're not immune to seeing how something like that may have impacted their parents.
Same for students to move forward is to redevelop their normal days.
The structure of a routine is a great way to help school feel like a safe place to be.
She says those who are worried just need comfort for the future.
Be reassured that school is a safe place and that the world is a safe place, but there's sometimes things that happen that are bad.
And now moving down the road, Dr. Best says students can have a delayed reaction to these types of situations. It's not common, but if there are symptoms of delayed trauma, it's important for parents to address it and get the appropriate help if needed.
Absolutely is. Nick, thanks for the live update there from our newsroom. To health news now, we're continuing to follow these trends with the flu this season. Here's a look at the CDC flu map where both Georgia and South Carolina, as you can see, are both in dark red. South Carolina even darker than Georgia. That means the two state is experiencing a very high level of spread. Hallie Turner checked in with health experts at AU Health to see what they're seeing as we head into these cooler months.
Sore throats, stuffy noses, body aches, and chest discomfort all walking through the hospital doors here in Augusta.
In the Augusta area, we normally see a peak of the flu season occurring in January, and we're seeing those types of volumes, but have been seeing those in November.
While RSV has been top of the worry list for many parents, Dr. Cool says cases are actually subsiding, but flu continues to rise.
I've seen some record volumes in our emergency department with respiratory and flu-like illnesses.
While there are two strains circulating, H3N2 remains dominant.
It's possible that we will have peaked out on one strain of the flu and may see a second peak of that occurring in our normal flu peak in January.
Dr. Cool says the early peak could be due to COVID.
Unclear exactly why we're seeing. Some of this is certainly the impact of wearing a mask and having strict social distancing that we're now relaxing.
And it's putting the ones they are most concerned about in the hospital.
Children under the age of 5, as well as those that are over 65, tend to be at the greatest risk from the flu. Those populations are the ones that we're concerned the most about during an outbreak like this.
And the CDC estimates there have been 2,900 deaths this season from the flu. So far this week in Georgia, two people have died and about 60 ended up in a hospital. Politics now, a new poll. Silver Gum here. Local businesses encouraging shoppers to make donations while they're out buying gifts for the holidays. How you can give local while shopping local. Coming up, Riley.
Well, it's going to be a cold night below freezing as we head into early Friday, but we are warming up those temps into the weekend. Take a look at that just after the break.
And for you,
that's the strong arm.
Spreading some Christmas spirit, organizers for the annual Trees for Troops event are handing out Christmas trees to service members and their families at Fort Gordon today. On top of that, there's also a Christmas festival to get the community on post into the holiday spirit. We spoke with one woman who says it's really important for people in the military and their families to celebrate the holidays, even if they're not able to travel home.
So it's important to us as an installation that our soldiers, especially the ones that aren't traveling to go home and the families that aren't able to be with their loved ones, wherever that is around the globe, that here they have a family, and that's why we make the most of what we have here at Fort Gordon.
And there was also a Christmas tree lighting after that giveaway. Going to take you out to Fort Gordon right now for a live look where things are still really festive on post tonight. Beautiful tree there up on stage. A lot of families posing for pictures and just having a good time outside tonight on this first night of December as we check in with First Alert Chief Meteorologist Riley Hale. And Riley, that is a perfect night out of Fort Gordon right there. Picture perfect.
It really is. We're seeing mostly clear skies. Temperatures are actually feeling a little bit like wintertime for us. And near Fort Gordon for rain looks a little bit better as we head next Monday and Tuesday.
Sounds good, Riley. Thanks so much. Local businesses teaming up to give back tonight, encouraging shoppers to donate comforters and coats while they're out buying gifts this holiday season. Maria Sellers over at Surrey Center, where businesses have red bins out in front of their stores to help out.
We get so much support from our community, so we just wanted to do something that we could say thank you and help others in need.
She said says supporting the Center of Hope is important because of the impact it has on the people in need in our community.
All the donations stay in Augusta, which is amazing, and it's just something small we felt like we could do to give back to the Augusta community.
And while it may seem small, leaders with the Salvation Army say it makes a big impact.
We can't do what we do without the people in the community stepping up and helping us raise the money, raise the goods that we need in order to help all those who are in need. So it's huge for us.
Faces of homelessness may look different than you think. The Salvation Army says they've served 94 families this year.
This year we've seen a big increase in the number of families in our Center of Hope, and that's we want to continue to be able to serve them as well as possible.
And he says it provides more than just the basic needs for the families they serve.
So a lot of these items provide dignity when you show up at the Center of Hope to come into the shelter your first time, and it's a rough night.
Multiple businesses doing their part to help do the most good.
The more support and the more people we have that are aware of this need in our community, we can all work together and have a bigger impact and get the message out even further than someone might be able to do on a smaller scale.
A great way to help out. So look for those bins in Surrey Center until the end of the day tomorrow. If you're interested in giving but can't make it over to the center, you can also donate at any Salvation Army location, including the Croc Center, the Center of Hope, or any of the family stores. Hope you will this season. Coming up, students at Thomas Jefferson Academy cheering on their football team, hoping for a state championship win in Macon. And that's where we are live with Dan in sports. Coming up next. Thomas Jefferson Academy in Lewisville with a big sending-off ceremony for the football team. They're heading over to Macon for their division state championship that happens right now, tonight. Students, faculty, the community, all coming out today to wish them luck on their trip over to the middle of the state. Dan Booth is live for us in Macon right now, covering that championship game for us. So, Dan, tell us, how are the Jags doing so far?
Thank you, Richard. Now, halftime is about to come to a close, and as of right now, Thomas Jefferson Academy has a 22-8 lead over the Robert Toombs Christian Crusaders. Now, the first half was entertaining. Thomas Jefferson got out early with the use of their running game and really set the tone to try to ease some of these tensions of playing in a state championship game. Now, I'm going to get behind the camera to give you guys an idea of what's going on the field. We have Thomas Jefferson getting ready to start the second half, doing some warm-ups here, getting everyone ready. And we're going to take a look at some of these seniors out there who have known nothing but winning since they took the field for this Thomas Jefferson team their freshman year, because they've won, like I said, their last three state championships, and they're trying to make it four tonight. Now, there's 12 seniors out there, and their head coach has a special connection with them, and he's trying to do everything that he can to help them finish their high school careers on top.
They mean a lot to me. My team thinks I favor them too much, but when you spend 5 years with people, with kids, like I've been with them since they were in eighth grade, we've cried together, we've bled together, we've sweat together, we've yelled at each other. You know, we've gone through a lot of adversity, and I think when that happens, they come together. And, you know, I love every one of them like they're my sons, and I just hope they play their best game tonight.
Thomas Jefferson, this team actually lost to this Robert Toombs team by 1 point about a month ago, and since that loss, they've taken their play to a whole new level, and then being back in the state championship game is just another example of what this team is capable when they get rolling, especially on the ground like they did in the first half. But stick around, because updates are going to keep coming throughout the night, and at 11 o'clock, I'm going to have a full recap of this game with post-game reaction, so you're not going to want to miss it. But for now, reporting from Mercer University in Macon, Dan Root on your side.
Dan, thanks for that, and good luck to those teams. Great time of year to be playing football. If you're playing now, you're one of the very best, Riley.
Absolutely. I'm glad Dan brought the winter gear out there. It is going to be a cold night and a cold Friday, but we do warm back up into the 70s by Saturday afternoon. That'll look the 7-day forecast just after break.
News 12, voted best weather coverage by the Georgia Association of Broadcasters.